season. It's my happiest time of year. I got all my scarves out. Anyway, so today, you know, sometimes you're scrolling through Facebook and social media, and whoo, I'm so done with politics. But sometimes there's beautiful things that are shared too, and something really struck me today, and I think it was something that Sarah had actually shared, and it was a little boy who was on his hands and knees trying to get a drink out of a mud puddle. And it was just a reminder to be thankful. And there's so much that we take for granted. We are so blessed. We are so blessed. And, you know, when our hearts are thankful, our whole perspective changes. And it was just a reminder to me today to stay thankful. Because when you're thankful for what you have is more than enough. And God has promised us that we will always have more than enough. And so I want to read out of Psalm 107 tonight. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his mercy and loving kindness endure forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has delivered from the hand of the adversary, and gathered them out of the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the Red Sea in the south. He's going to find us wherever we may wander, wherever our hearts, wherever our thoughts, wherever our feet may take us. He's always going to find us and bring us back. And it makes us and encourages us to be thankful, to just think about our blessings. You know, there's so many things that we can worry about. I don't know how many of us are worriers, but it's so easy. It's so easy to just be distracted and to start to worry. What if, what if, what if, what if? You know, no matter what it is, even the blessings, sometimes you can find a way to worry about a blessing. And just to rest and let go of all those what ifs and just trust that the Lord is good and he has a plan. And I believe that that's wisdom, right? It's wisdom to not allow our minds, our carnal minds, to just steal our joy. And I think that being thankful humbles us because we remember who our source is. It's not about me. It's not about what I've earned. It's the blessings that I've received. It's the God that has lifted me up and blessed me and given me favor. And lastly, I'm going to read out of Colossians chapter 3, verses 15 through 17. And let the peace, the soul harmony which comes from Christ's rule, act as umpire continually in your hearts, deciding and settling with finality all questions that arise in your minds in that peaceful state to which, as members of Christ's one body, you are also called to live. And be thankful, be appreciative, giving praise to God always. Let the words spoken by Christ, the Messiah, have its home in your hearts and your minds and dwell in you in all its richness as you teach and admonish and train one another in insight and intelligence and wisdom in spiritual things. And as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody to him with his grace in your heart. And whatever you do, no matter what it is, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus and in dependence upon his person, giving praise to God the Father through him. It's so easy and it's so hard to rest. To rest, to hold our peace, to be thankful, and to just trust that our God is good and will provide for all of our needs.
Amen.
And let the peace, that soul harmony, rule our minds and our hearts in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Anyone have any prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Yeah, Nathan. He was a 16-year-old young man. It was a tragic accident.
Terrible.
Yeah, a terrible accident.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, anyone else tonight? Yeah.
Yes, we would appreciate prayers for this weekend. We have to work Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So we'll be gone this weekend. But I always appreciate prayers for that. You know, whenever we're doing things for Valley, doing things for DMAC too, I always appreciate protection. Today, church is still going on to this day. And my grandma was one of the founders of that church. And he was the pastor for, 50, 60 years. I mean, he was a pastor a long time down at that church. So it touches you that he stayed faithful all those years, you know. So I just wanted to continue to touch his family.
And I'd like to ask for prayer. One of my high school friends, her stepdaughter is Jordan Allen. I don't know if anybody saw Channel 13 News last night at 10, but she was just diagnosed with a very aggressive stage 4 cancer. She's a young girl. She's a freshman at UNI. She's an all-star track runner. Beautiful young girl with her whole life before her. And her story is that she's battling with positivity. She's trying to encourage others as she goes through this journey herself, and her goal is to be on the Ellen Show.
Yeah.
So I shared her post, Allen for Ellen is her hashtag, and just pray for Jordan and for her family. She has a lot of younger brothers and sisters, and you know, my friend's been her stepmother for many, many years, and that's like her daughter. So just remember Jordan.
Lift up Myron. I know he hasn't been here. I hadn't heard how the skin graft went. I see a couple posts and stuff like that, but I haven't had a chance to talk to him. So just pray for him. Doug comes to mind. We haven't seen Doug in a few weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But lift him up. He with Cindy, she was doing better. She changed her medication around a little bit, the antibiotics versus the probiotics versus the prebiotics. The doctors can't tell her exactly how to, so she's basically praying for wisdom in that. She seems to be doing better. She almost came tonight, but just tired and breathlessness. So praying for her understanding, wisdom, that God's healing upon her, just claiming that healing to come forth. And pray for me as I do Sunday school Sunday.
Yes, sir.
I'm glad you said you and not the kids.
The kids are actually really excited to have Mike as their teacher.
I'm really
Carol, yes.
Pastor isn't instructing you people that come along to preach like you should. The person that sits in this seat, me, is almost totally deaf. I have my hearing aids on. They're turned up as far as they'll go. I still can't hear you.
Okay. Do I need to speak louder?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I sure will. Okay. I'll try and keep an eye on you, Carol. Just wave a hand if you can't hear me.
What?
Tim pretty well.
Amen.
All right. I'll remember to check. All right. Anyone else? All right. Let's stand and pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight. Lord, we lift up all these needs before you, Lord, those who need traveling mercies, those who are not with us, those who are far apart, Lord, and those who need healing tonight. We thank you for your encouragement. We thank you, Lord, that we can stand upon your word, Lord, and trust that you have finished it. You have finished the work, Lord. We ask you to comfort the family who lost their son. Lord, you've promised us to count it all for joy, Lord, and that you will use all things for your good. And we just ask that you bless that family that mourns right now, Lord, that you encourage that family, draw them together, and let your name be lifted high in the midst, Lord. Jesus, we pray for Miss Jordan right now, Jordan Allen, Lord, and the battle of cancer that she faces. We know that you're our healer, Lord, and that you would encourage her and you would heal her body, Lord, and that she would give you the glory in all that she does, Lord. Jesus, be with those in our body, in our church who are not here tonight. Be with Cindy. Touch her lungs, Lord. Give her wisdom on how to move past, to be healed, Lord, to be whole, Lord. Be with Myron, Lord, in that situation. Heal that wound. And let him move on, Lord, in victory, Lord. We pray for Doug, who's not here tonight, Lord. Let him know that he is missed. Encourage him, Lord. Encourage him, Lord, to know that he is part of this body, Lord. Draw him out, Lord. Draw all those out who are hurting, who are hiding, Lord. Draw them into your presence, Lord. We know that you have a purpose and a plan for this house of prayer. Lord, and tonight we lift up our nation to you, the United States of America. We're facing an election where many Americans don't know what to do for the first time in many years. The fear that's being promoted in the media, Lord, the anger, the hate, the speech. Let your truth rise up, Lord. Let the truth of who you are rise up, Lord. Give your people wisdom, Lord, and help them put their hope and their trust in you, not in a king or in a president, Lord, but in you, the one true king, Jesus. Come and have your way tonight in this service, Lord. Come meet with us tonight, Lord. It's you that we serve. It's you that we love. It's you that we choose to spend our Wednesday night with, Lord, and each other. We come because we love you. We come because you first loved us and called us for a purpose and a plan to be part of your kingdom. Stir up the gifts in each of us, Lord. Stir up the gifts that we might walk in the maturity of the ministry and the gifts that you called and placed in each of us, Lord. Help us to know and to remember that we are blessed to be a blessing to others. Lord, help us to be thankful in all things. You are the source of all things good. And we thank you, Lord, for your blessings and your mercy and your grace, Lord, every day. We thank you that you came and dwelt among us, Lord. And you died and you laid your life down that we might be one with you forever. And you took the keys to death, hell, and the grave, Lord. You conquered death. What else is there to fear? If you be for us, Lord, who can be against us? Jesus. Jesus. We love you tonight, Lord. Holy Spirit, come have your way in this service tonight. Speak to us, Lord. Speak to our hearts and our minds, Lord. Give us wisdom and revelation as we follow after you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Just a reminder that if you brought a cell phone with you, to please turn the volume down or to turn it off. And this Friday is Eastern Gate House of Prayer.
Voting gathering for our nation. We're going to just stand in the gap. It's a lot of things on the line. There's a lot of naysaying going on. Then there's a lot of arguments going back and forth, even between, you know, those that know that the right choices, the wrong choices, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But the bottom line is his kingdom rules and reigns, and we just need to be focused on his kingdom and just pray for wisdom for those that are currently in leadership. We're supposed to pray for those in leadership, but let's pray for wisdom on those that are going to be casting their votes, that the blinders would come off, that they would see truth. I know the Lord is gracious because there's a remnant in this country, so I pray that that remnant would rise up, not hide their houses and just go out and vote like they need to be doing, be responsible, but mostly just seek after the kingdom of the Lord. And we're going to come together. We're going to come together this Friday night and have this pre-election gathering. It's not going to be a political thing. It's going to be a kingdom thing. We will have communion, as tried to relay last month. Ron's going to help out with the communion, observing the elements, etc., and just having a time together. And the Lord also showed me, and some of the people from Voices of Joy and Praise will be here too, just to join in with the fellowship and stuff, because there's a spirit of reconciliation, not only happening in the atmosphere, but it's actually happening in the natural. Yeah. So just pray for this time. It's going to be, I come expecting.
Yeah.
That's all I can say.
Amen. All right, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Ron, you want to come take the offering for us tonight, please?
Confirms there were what 14, 15 of us here?
Thank you. Thank you for being an ever-present help in the time of trouble. You are a great and a mighty God. There's none like you, Lord. And with you, nothing is impossible. We praise you tonight, Lord, for who you are and for your great love. And we bless you tonight in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Praise God. God bless you. Thanks, Suzanne, for opening, and thank you for taking care of the Sunday stuff. Amen. Thank you, Mike, for everything you're doing. Praise the Lord. And thank all of you for your prayers. God is good. Hallelujah. And, you know, stupid stuff happens. You know, some days you're the pigeon, and some days you're the statue. Never sure what day that's going to be when you get up in the morning. Everything's good in Jesus. Hallelujah. We're doing better. God's still on the throne. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So thank God. I was telling Suzanne a little while ago, you know, Sally was accusing me of being abnormal. Of course, it's not a new thing. I said, I tried normal once. It was the longest 3 minutes of my life. So I've tried to move on from there. Hallelujah. So let's get right into this tonight. And if you will, Mike, let's begin with 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 22. Can you hear me, Carol? Samuel said, "Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." Hallelujah. Okay, Hosea chapter 6, verse 6. "For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings." Thank the Lord. I'm trying to see if my antenna is out here. There we go. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and we'll just read verses 1 through 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 10. It is is not expedient for me, doubtless, to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. God knoweth. Such a one caught up into the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. How that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter. Of such a one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in mine infirmities. For though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. And lest I should be exalted above measure, through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong. Now, that's what's been called over the years the spirituality of imperfection. And I'm really glad about that, praise the Lord. I don't know about anybody else, but that's me, hallelujah, the spirituality of imperfection. But, you know, people are tempted to believe that obedience may be demanding but achievable if you put enough self-will, enough of your mind to it, and work really hard, you can arrive. Amen? But there's two problems with that. And the first is that doing what God asks is something that we can't accomplish in ourselves. Not only did God never mean for us to accomplish it in ourselves, he intended that our failures would lead us, you know, what we think of as sin, failure of obedience, or coming short of God's perfection. We think that we can do that, but the truth is it's supposed to lead us to surrender, not to achievement. And God wants our failure in obedience to lead us to him, to make us aware of our need for him. The second thing is with this, in simply trying to do what God asks, is that it leaves the kingdom of God outside of the picture, and the kingdom of self in charge. So I remain in control, so that I am the God of my life. The whole point of the kingdom of God is to overcome or to overturn the kingdom of self.
That's right.
To obey is to submit to authority, the authority of somebody or someone or something. Obedience in this context is submission to God. Look at Matthew chapter 8, verse 27. And I'll just show you a couple of examples here. What I'm talking about. Matthew 8:27. There's this great storm, and Jesus calms the storm. Peace be still, remember? But the men marvel, saying, what manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? Amen? So, in this case, the winds and the sea submit to the authority of God, and it's called obedience. Okay? Look at Mark chapter 1, verse 27. And they were all amazed, insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him. So again, submission. This unclean spirit submitted to the authority of Christ, and it's referred to here again as obedience. And the truth is, both unclean spirits and human spirits have to submit. They have to obey. Amen? So, obedience is surrender to the authority that liberates us. It's not about trying to put you in a pen or try to lock you up or keep you, you know, rigidly controlled. But the purpose of obedience is to liberate us, to cause us to submit to God, and that sets us free. Disobedience is refusing to submit.
Amen.
It's clear to me that God doesn't want us just to have behavioral compliance. That's really not what this is all about. In fact, look at Romans chapter 6 and verse 17. God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but you have obeyed from the heart. And that's the key here, from the heart, that form of doctrine which was delivered you. So, motivation is what we're talking about in this case. It counts. Amen. It counts because what God is really after is our love and our friendship, our intimacy. Amen. Not just right behavior. In fact, that's down the list as far as God's concerned. We make it a big deal because it puts us back in charge, what we're doing and what we're not doing and so on and so forth. Amen. So if he just wanted compliance, he could have just created a whole world of automatons, you know, or robots or something that would just do whatever he said, and then he would have been completely happy if that was his goal. If that's what he wanted, was just compliance and just obedience in that sense, then why not make it that way? So that everybody does obey, so everybody just does exactly what you say. Amen? All right, look at Matthew chapter 5 and verses 21 and 22. And Jesus touches on this very thing in this Sermon on the Mount, and he says, you've heard that it was said of them of old time, thou shalt not kill, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment, and whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. His brother's not Raca, that's just a word. Shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. So obviously there's a thing going on the inside that he's more concerned about. Then I know what some of you thought this was Rocco or Rocky.
No.
Just in case. I mean, you're not. I know you're not. But I just love taking advantage of it every once in a while. Praise the Lord. So you see what I'm saying? This is Jesus is obviously telling us this isn't about the outside. This isn't about obedience because, hey, I've never killed anybody, you know, in a social setting, you know. I mean, I'm not talking about in combat or anything, but just, you know, in a natural thing. There's been some people I've really disliked and maybe even hated. I don't know for sure the definition or how you can define that. But I never killed them. So I kept that law. But Jesus is saying that's not keeping the law, because the problem with this thing is it's an internal thing. It's not the external that I'm looking for. So the obedience that we think of is not really what God is after. And in fact, it goes on even further in verse 27 and 28, Mike, same chapter here. A woman, you look on a woman, you know, the whole thing. You've heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say to you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. So again, the heart issue is what God's really trying to deal with. Amen? So, yeah, you never killed anybody, but in terms of God's perfection, you're still a murderer, mm-hmm. if you've had that desire. Likewise with the woman, the same situation. Or man, you know, I mean, it's all the same. So what I'm saying here is to rely on the will to make things happen keeps the focus on me, on self. Amen? On the kingdom of self. Yeah. I'm still in charge. I'm still ruling in this realm. Amen? Instead of willpower and resolve, love is supposed to be the motivation. That's the pattern of real Christian spiritual transformation. It doesn't happen any other way. You can have all the rules, and everybody can be abiding by the rules, and still be totally unchanged and untransformed by the Spirit of God. Transformation always works from the inside out. When I say we, I mean religiously, what we've tried to do is, you know, just patch up the cracks in the barn and paint it nice and bright and forget about the fact that it's about to cave in. Looks better, looks presentable, but inside it's crumbling, you know? And that's the same thing God is talking about. Love is always the source, the motivation, and the expression of what God wants in our lives. Look at John, if you will, Mike. John chapter 8 verse 36. The Son, therefore, shall make you free. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Amen?
Amen.
So being made in the image of God means that failing to find our freedom in surrender to God brings frustration and disappointment. The harder you try, the better to be, the worse you are. That's basically Romans 7. That's what Paul's saying. The more I make it about me, the more I realize I'm a flop. I just can't do it. And that's why it's the love of God that's shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us, that carries us into this transformation that God wants to take place so that we can have this intimacy with Him. And Jesus is the key to surrendering to God. He makes that possible for us. Amen? He doesn't command us to surrender or exercise authority over us and demand obedience. Instead, He welcomes us with love that invites intimacy.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to perform. He just says, I love you. Just, you know, how we always say, come as you are, you know, whatever. And then we demand all kinds of other things once they've come.
Right.
Instead of commanding with power, Jesus invites us with vulnerability. He makes Himself vulnerable. He makes it possible for us to refuse Him if we want. He becomes vulnerable when He could command and demand, but He refuses to. Look, John chapter 10, verses 10 and 11. He wants to give us life and that more abundantly. The thief comes not but to steal, kill, and destroy. I've come that they might have life, they might have it more abundantly. I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives His life for the sheep. Now it's a paradox because the abundant life promised us in Jesus comes from releasing, not grasping.
Right.
It comes from letting go instead of trying to hang on in your own strength. Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 and 30 is a perfect expression of that, where He says, come unto me all you that labor, are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So abundant life comes from relinquishing rather than striving. From letting go rather than grasping. Amen. It's surrender to live my life in the grace of God. You have to surrender your will. It doesn't make a lot of sense, you know, in the natural, intellectually, to say that, you know, the way I arrive, the way I achieve, the way I get the reality of who I am in Christ is not by me doing something. It's actually by me not doing anything. Personally, you know, humanly speaking. It's relaxing and letting go. Surrender is being willing instead of willful. It's willingness to trust God's love. And that's what surrender is all about. It's relaxing and letting go. It's floating in that river that is always being spoken of here, which is the love of God.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, let's look at that in Ezekiel chapter 47, verses 1 through 5. We'll just touch on this real quick. When I was going through boot camp, they used to have a thing called drown proofing. And I was a fairly good swimmer as a kid. We swam in rivers and, you know, ponds, and every once in a while we needed to go to a pool. Actually, I think the rivers and ponds were much cleaner, but that's another story. But I always liked swimming. I always liked the water, the beach, and whatever. And so I was a fairly good swimmer. But when they make you jump in this pool with all your clothes on, including your boots and everything else, all of a sudden it's a whole other ballgame. And you can't tread water. They won't let you. And what you do is you just go limp, drop your head, and you'll sink. But as soon as you relax, you'll come back to the surface. You're lungs are really higher in your back than we think, and it just pulls you up. You just relax and you take a breath, and you'll sink again, and then you'll come back up. That's because if you're in the ocean for a day or two without a raft or anything else, you're not going to tread water for 48 hours. You're going to cramp up and sink and die. So it's a way of forcing yourself to relax and not think about drowning, because that's where everybody freaks out, is, oh, I'm going to drown. So they get all excited and wear themselves out, and they actually end up drowning. But that was the purpose for drown proofing. But floating is a similar thing. It's just a little bit different dynamic. So he says, afterward, he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood toward the east, and the waters came down from under the right side of the house on the south side of the altar. Then brought he me out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the utter gate by the way that looketh eastward, and behold, there ran waters on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles. Then he measured 1,000 and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees. Again he measured 1,000 and brought me through. The waters were to the loins. Afterward he measured 1,000 to a river that I could not pass over. For the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. I think I always see the analogy here for me that I see all the time in the scripture is just like, it's like Gideon. You know, I want you to do this thing, but I'm going to make it impossible for you to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You see it over and over. God will call somebody to do something, but it's set up in a way that the guy says, it can't be done. That's the key, because God's wanting to do it. He's wanting you to let go and let him, to just trust in him. So that floating is a good illustration, because you can't float until you let go.
Amen.
Floating is putting your full weight on the water. Relaxing and trusting that you'll be supported by that water. As long as you're panicky, as long as you're freaking and worrying, you won't float. But the moment you let go, you will come to the surface. That's why dead bodies float. They're not struggling anymore. Amen. So, praise the Lord. I don't know what that meant, but it's out there anyway. But it's letting go of your natural instincts to fight against sinking.
Yeah.
That's this whole thing we're talking about here.
Mm-hmm.
When you relax and let go, that's when you discover you are being supported by the very water that you're afraid of.
Mm-hmm.
Early Christians, you still see them today, the bumper stickers or the little chrome fish. That's why. You know, you go back centuries, Christians were epitomized by the fish. That was their symbol. They'd scratch it in the dirt, you know, to identify one another, you know, when it was not so popular to be a Christian. And that's the reason for it. The fish just floats through the water, right? It doesn't have a problem. And that was the early symbol of Christianity, and it still exists in some realms today. Look at John chapter 4, verses 10 through 14. John 4, 10 through 14. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith that he give me to drink, thou wouldst have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman said unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. You know, the reason fish aren't afraid of water is because they don't drown. I mean, they have a different breathing system.
Mm-hmm.
Gills, you know, the whole thing. And we're in this world, but we're not of the world.
Right.
But we can maneuver through this world like a fish maneuvers through water. That's what God is trying to get us to understand. As awkward and as weird as it all seems, if we just relax, we find out that we can maneuver. We can manipulate. We can get through all of this. Amen. The Holy Spirit is the water that's being spoken of here.
Yeah.
Right? So we have this in us.
Sure.
But if you got the water in you, why would you be worried about the water that's out of you?
Come on.
You know, that's around you, you know, the situations and the circumstances, okay? Look at Revelation chapter 22, verses 1 and 2. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, there was tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nation. So faith, then, is the ability to trust the river, to trust the flow, to trust the source, to trust the lover. Praise the Lord. The river is God's love. And the reason we don't have to be afraid is that we've been given the Spirit of God. We are in the river. We don't need to thrash around and freak out. We need to float.
Yep.
Surrender to love is never a once and for all deal. And it won't take you long to figure that out if you haven't already. I surrender. And then I lift my head out of the water to look around and see how far I've moved or what's around me, and I sink. I have to start over again.
Mm-hmm.
I got to let go and relax. And immediately, I start to rise. So I surrender again, and I trust that I'm supported. And lo and behold, I am. Life is not so much, you know, it's like the old joke. It's not the ups and downs in life. It's the little jerks that are the problems.
So, yeah.
You know, it's not the life. It's the sudden panicking and freaking and thrashing around trying to make something happen that if we would just let go and let God, it's an old cliche, but it's valid. You know, it's real. Just relax. Every once in a while, we got to pop up and see, you know, how much progress have I made? You know, what's this problem coming up over here? And the next thing I know, I got to start treading water. Or else I just let go and relax. Come unto me, all you that labor. I'll give you rest. In the midst of all the crisis, He's the answer. He is our flotation device. Praise the Lord. You're not sitting on it. Hallelujah. It's the Lord Himself. All right, let's wrap up with this. Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39, and hopefully this will kind of encapsulate what I'm saying here. Romans 8, 31 through 39. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?
Mm-hmm.
He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifies. Who is he that condemneth? It's Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. God, just my suggestion tonight as we close is let go and let God.
Amen.
You have the river. Just float. I'll tell you a little story. This has nothing to do with this except that it just came to my mind. Sometimes I have a problem filtering. And years ago, when I was still I hadn't been out of the military very long, and I was experimenting with a lot of drugs and stuff. My younger brother, who's 2 years younger than I, decided we would take a real adventure So we were going to raft down the river. But we made the mistake of taking mescaline first, and we floated about maybe 50 yards, and we realized there's people standing on the bridge that passed over the river, an automobile bridge. We're not getting any closer. And we laid there, and they're looking at us like, what are these guys doing? And we're looking at each other and looking up there and thinking, man, this is, what a trip. This is weird. It's like we're not moving at all. So after about 45 minutes of this, and the people really laughing now and pointing and carrying on and stuff, I decided to reach out and paddle us along. Maybe we could get into the current. And I reached out, and I'm touching the sand. We were stuck in the sand. The water was only about this deep. I'm just saying. Stupid is as stupid does, you know? Can't float if you're grounded.
Right.
You know? So I'm just saying, let go and let God.
Amen.
Get in the flow of the river, trust in the love of God, and He'll get you to your destination without embarrassment, humiliation, or hangovers. Praise the Lord. God is good all the time, and He's the source of all in us, around us, through us. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Float on, everybody. Float on. All right. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.
Woo-hoo! Yes, Lord.
And I'm not on any medication, by the way. This is just that, you know, 3 minutes that I gave up of normalcy. So God bless everybody. Great having you here. Hope to see you back here Sunday or Friday. Especially after you've had, you know, 75-degree weather the day before and then 40 the next. Hey, Tim. God bless, brother.